Thank you. So let me thank you very much for inviting me to this conference. I think that is a very good idea to remember our good friend Cyrano de Dominicis, which have spent so many years here in this building, and both as director, and he worked here for such a long time. And I will speak about the energy landscape near Gemmin, and I will try to essentially connect to the so-called SAT-UNSAT transition for random satiability problem. And essentially, this is the plan of my talk. I will introduce a discrete constraint satisfaction problem. I will consider the continuous one. After, I will go to half sphere, and I will trace one new feature that arrives in this case, in some of this case, that is called Gardner transition. I will discuss about Gemmin and some of the open problem. Now, let me just remind to you about the constraint satisfaction problem. In constraint satisfaction problem, we have a certain number of n variable, m constraint, and we have to find something that satisfies all the constraint. There are many examples of these things, and you have already, I believe. And one problem, for example, is a graph coloring problem. You have a graph, each node may be colored in q different ways. If the nodes however, you have to impose a constraint that adjacent node are colored in a different way, and if this can be done, the graph is colorable. And therefore, you have this problem. This is a problem of coloring a graph. And now, what people know is that if you have a random ensemble, when you have some what mathematicians call the 0-1 law, this means that when n goes to infinity, a fixed ratio n over m, the graph is colorable with probability, is colorable depending on the value of alpha, or it's not colorable with certain, or it is colorable. And if you take some kind of ensemble, what happens is the graph may be, everything may be computed in this type of situation. That is well known. And now essentially you can go on, you can do some analysis using the replica method. You can take two solutions of the problem. By solution means something that satisfies the constraint. You can study the overlap between this solution, or if you prefer, you can define a distance. The overlap at the distance have just related one to the other, the sum is equal to one. And you find that at a certain moment, you find that the space of all solution breaks into clusters. And now what you have to really to count is the number, what interests is the number of clusters. And what happens is that the number of clusters is usually exponentially large. But this function sigma, which control the number of clusters, if you wanted the entropy of clusters, is going to zero at the critical point where the solution disappears. And the solution are not solution for greater value of that. So the typical picture, if you look to the typical picture of the space of solution, this is the space of allowed solution. For alpha less than a certain value, alpha dynamic, at that moment, when you go near to alpha dynamics, you find that there's some solution, there's other solution here, you have a small bridge for going from one set of solution to another set of solution. When you cross alpha dynamics, you have these regions here. Therefore, you get clusters, and after that you get clusters, you have to count them, and at a certain moment, then these clusters disappear. If now there are techniques to study these things using the method of replicas, and this picture, if you use the language of replicas, is what people call one-step replica symmetry breaking. Now, you can go on and you can just change slightly the problem and you can go to what you can call the continuous graph coloring. In the continuous graph coloring, each node is an angle in the interval 0 to pi, of course I assume periodic boundary condition, and now you ask that the two nodes, two adjacent nodes, have a difference greater than the center value of delta. And now this and if this is possible, the graph may be delta colorable. Now you have, of course, this is a problem that is very similar to the previous one, but the difference is now that the color are real number, where in the other case the color is discrete. This model is, if one knows, is very similar, essentially the one-dimensional model of Marica, Kraskal, and Kurchan that was introduced for glasses, but of course it can has its meaning as a coloring model. Now, the thing that happens now, the interesting, that when you go to continuous variable, things are going to, there's a new feature that appear that are not present with a discrete variable. Suppose that you have a very simple satisfaction problem. You have these three inequalities, positive x, positive y, x plus y greater than q. It's clear that the solution is, the problem is solution only for positive q, and the volume of solution is q squared divided 2. Now, when q goes to 0, not only the solution disappears, but the volume of the solution shrinks to 0. This was not possible in the discrete case, because in the discrete case you have at least one solution. Here the volume is going to 0, so you can the volume may become less than 1 and so on. The other thing that happens is quite clear that some of the when you arrive to the certain sub point, the point that separates satisfiability from unsatisfiability, some of the variables are blocked. I mean, the variable that are blocked usually said they are jamming. Now, once that we look to the, let's now look to the problem half sphere. A sphere is something that we know. We have a particle in a box. The potential is the sum of two-body potential. The potential is infinite if the distance is less than the diameter, and the potential is zero otherwise. The fact that the potential is, that was x greater than the diameter. The fact that the potential is infinite means that any allowed configuration should satisfy this constraint. And now you see that this can be considered as a continuous constraint satisfaction model, because you have a certain number of variables which have the position, the point, and you have all this type of constraint. Now, if you have of course, if you want to do something slightly more realistic, you could also consider harmonic sphere. For example, sphere which may be slightly deformed with pressure. And now it's clear that the jamming point, where it's a point where the particle in contact cannot be moved, may be obtained or the infinite pressure limit of sphere. Or you can go at zero temperature for the soft sphere and arrive to the point where the energy is becoming zero. And the two things are related. But the introduction of the soft model, also if you go to jamming, is interesting because it allows you to ask other questions like the spectrum of small oscillation of vibration and so on and so on. And now, the point that you have there's many other constraint satisfaction problems which maybe are not very interesting for applications of solid state physics. For example, one problem may be the perceptron. The perceptron is something that is very well studied by a long tradition of studying the perceptron in statistical mechanics. essentially you have a certain random vector, and you want to find a vector x such that the angle the scalar product is bigger than a certain value of kappa. Now, usually the most studied perception is kappa equal to zero, which corresponds to hyperplane to find one hyperplane such that all the points are on one side of the hyperplane. But you can formulate this problem both for positive kappa and from negative kappa, and the region which, okay. And also in all these cases, you have the SAT-UNSAT transition. One problem, for example, practical problem of the same kind is to put your baggage in the car. Also, this is a transferability problem. They may, depending on the baggage, may be hard or soft. But the other problem that is interesting, suppose that you have a feed-forward neural network, and you have the synaptic strengths, a continuous variable, as usual, and you want to find a network that learns a certain rule, a certain kind from example. Now, also this is a constraint satisfaction problem. And what happens is that there will be, if you ask too much, the network will not be able to learn. And therefore, you have a transition from learning phase, from a phase where it cannot learn, and also these things is similar, belong to the same class of problem. Also, let us me mention, before I go to the detail, that if one interested to do in hard sphere and to study analytically, one interested to do something like a mean field type of computation. One model for hard sphere, which play the role, at least conceptual, to be able to do mean field type computation, is a Mary-Kurtzschel model. The Mary-Kurtzschel model is a slight deformation on the standard model, because in the standard model, this would be the Hamiltonian of the standard model for half sphere, but you can write these things for any potential you want. And the only new feature of the Mary-Kurtzschel model is this shift lambda ak. Now, the idea of Mary and Kurtzschel is that this vector are quenched and they have a random distribution on the cube. Therefore, this means that each particle is shifted to another particle by something like a random vector. Now, what can be proved quite easily is that if you stay in the liquid phase, this model is trivial, because you can compute the virial expansion, and all terms of the virial expansion are equal to zero. So the only non-trivial feature may arrive for something which is non-perturbative, like class transition and so on. And one feature that, therefore, this model being soluble in the high temperature phase is a good candidate for mean field theory. And also what you, the observations that you can do, that if you do the virial expansion for half sphere in a certain range of parameters that are relevant for the study, when you go to the infinite dimension limit, you go to very high dimension, you get also, in this case, that all the terms of the virial expansion equal to zero. So both models coincide when d is equal to infinity, and one can essentially do in this, there can be the starting point from mean field approximation. Essentially, what you do in mean field is essentially to neglect a non-trivial diagram of the virial expansion. Okay, now we can think of these two models. We can try to set up a replica approach for this problem. And I will not write a formula which is quite long. And I have a sense that the main conceptual steps is that first you have to introduce replicas, in some way. And the second thing is that once that you introduce n certain number of replicas, n replicas, you can introduce a matrix delta AB. A and B are the replica indices. I is the position of the particle that tells you how one particle is displaced with the other one from one going from one replica to another replica. Now, the main point is to compute the free energy as function of delta. Of course, this may be done for R-sphere, but can be done also for perceptron type model. For perceptron type model is something quite standard because it was done 30 years ago. And now the thing that you can do if you want to study, for example, this object like standard spin glasses, you can introduce a function of the parameter delta of x, which is equivalent to qx in spin glass. In some sense, this function delta of x is a special parametrization of this matrix here. I'm using here the language of spin glasses. One could use of replicas. One could go forget about replicas, and in principle one can do with cavity approximation. Using cavity and so on, which would make more sense from the probabilistic point of view. And now, essentially, once that you have written the free energy and so on, you can solve the model by computing the function delta x as function of the different parameter. Therefore, in principle, using the same procedure that is done for spin glass, you can solve the model. The only difference, not the only difference, one important difference is that in the case of spin glass, due to Guerra, Talagrand, Panchenko, and so on, we have a proof that the solution is correct. Here, there are technical points for which we cannot prove also in the case of the perceptron that the things is. I mean, my understanding is that the Guerra interpolation method people have not been able to work with the Guerra interpolation method in this particular case. Okay, now the thing that is quite unexpected, that is a new part that was not before, is the Gardner transition. Therefore, the picture that this is essentially the same picture should be here before. This part here is the liquid phase where the particle something. You have all configuration, legal configurations that satisfy the constraint. One can go from one configuration to another one. You have a moment in which the bridge between this region here becoming smaller and smaller. Once that you this bridge disappears, you form the cluster. Therefore, the system may stay in one region of configuration space or another region of configuration space. It cannot jump off one region of configuration space. And this is something that is detected when one replica is breaking. And at that moment, the new phenomena that was in some way quite unexpected, however, it comes out from the tail computation, that what people call the Gardner transition, this region here breaks down in smaller region, which breaks down in smaller region. Therefore, you move in this direction here physically, or increasing the pressure, or increasing the density, and up to arrive to the maximum compressed situation, which corresponds to jump state. And therefore, jamming corresponds to when you send the pressure to infinity. Of course, one thing that is crucial is that in all this picture, I'm neglecting crystallization. I close my eye on the possibility of having a crystal state. This is not present, certainly, in the MK model. In reality, I could say, for example, looking to some configuration which in the phase space or configuration that are not far from the liquid state and so on. Therefore, forget for the moment the crystallization, because otherwise crystallization will be a completely different story. Now, if you do this in this picture here, you arrive at a situation that when you arrive to the gem state, each gem deconfiguration, each gem configuration is surrounded by many other gem deconfiguration, and therefore the picture will be completely different from the situation in which this region here will be shrink, because you would get isolated point in configuration space. Now, it's clear that now, how these things, therefore, one way to say, if you want, in a pictorial way, that you stay at some small density, the phase space in which you can move is something like that. When you increase the density, these things break in this way, but this is something that corresponds to the usual one-step replica symmetry breaking, or the formation of cage in glasses where the particle cannot move. Therefore, this is a standard phenomenon of glassification. Now, the new phenomenon with the Gardner transition, that each of these things here increasing the density breaks down a smaller cage, and each of these cages breaks a smaller and smaller cage when you increase the pressure up to the moment where you arrive to infinite pressure. Therefore, this is what this phenomenon is what comes out from analytic computation and correspond to what people call continuous replica symmetry breaking. Now, the thing that is quite interesting is that if you write down the equation that you have to describe these things, the phenomena, they are not so very different. However, there are some crucial details from the one that one uses in spin glasses, and the whole understanding of spin glass and so on may be used in this case. Now, that's the problem, however, is if this, let me describe which are the result that comes out from in field theory. The result, if we think of a soft of harmonic sphere, the gem transition is at the center of the replica broken phase, in the sense that if you decrease the density, you go in the liquid phase where there's no replica symmetry breaking, continuous, and if you increase too much the density, you go to the situation where sphere strongly overlap, and also in this case, the replica symmetry breaking disappear. And however, the fact that the replica symmetry is broken, a physical consequence, there will be some kind of susceptibilities will be divergent, and as we know, and the other thing that if one looks into the tension of the computation, one finds that new other susceptibility divergent not only divergent only at the point of jamming, so jamming becomes a special point for the point of view of smaller or susceptibility. It becomes like a critical point. For example, the thing that you can see this type of phenomenon if you look to the spectrum of small oscillations. Of course, the spectrum of small oscillations is the region where the particles do overlap. Otherwise, the analysis is somewhat slightly more complex. And therefore, you can look to the spectrum as far as small oscillation to the spectrum of frequency. Therefore, you suppose that you have you write x dot twice dot, and you look to the equal to the force, and therefore you are just a harmonic oscillator. You have what you get in the replica symmetric case. You have a gap. The reason is the following: because we stay in infinite, usually you would have a phonon, but we stay in infinite dimensional space where there are no phonons. Therefore, if there are no phonons, what will remain usually is a gap. When you arrive, when you arrive to the replica broken case, there is no gap, and you find a spectrum which is proportional to omega square. Therefore, you get some contribution, extra contribution from extra fluctuation, extra zero mode, and these are the typical zero modes that are present also in the Sherrington-Kilpatrick model. And when you arrive to Gemin, you get lots of zero modes near omega equal to zero, the density of modes become constant at near small omega. Therefore, you get a situation no mode, no zero frequency mode in the replica symmetric. You get some modes with extra density which is proportional to omega square and something which is equal to a constant. Therefore, this means that the situation change a lot. The other things that you can try to study in the mean field theory, for example, you can look to the G of R. This is a typical G of R of the fluid, which tells you the probability of finding two particles at distance R. Now, G of R is obviously zero, where R is less than the diameter. And you find that the infinite pressure limit, G of R, has a singular behavior, like when the particles are touching. You can define in some way the force between the particle, and you find that also the distribution of the force has some singular behavior, force equal to zero. You can look how much the particle displays as function of the pressure, and also is characterized by another exponent. And the things that you find that all these exponents are non-trivial if you compute in the mean field theory. Now, these exponents are not independent in the sense that there is a phenomenological analysis which essentially was done by Riart and also some collaborator, similar to the one that was done by Schelling-Noah before Wilson, by Kardanoff and so on, reducing everything to two exponents for the standard exponent. Everything may be reduced to one exponent. And this exponent are not in. If you look to simulations in three dimensions, in many dimensions, you find the value of this exponent are not. Well, it's 1.4 and 1.4, and it's not 1/2.
In which dimension?
Okay, I will come to these things here. These are the result. These are the result in dimensions 8, 6, 4, and 3. And you see that the result do not seem to be particularly dependent on the dimension, which is quite surprising. And just to see to show you the sensitivity for of the value of the exponent, this line here is one of the pressure to the 3/2, and this line here is the pressure to 1.4. So you see that there are some exponents, they do not seem to be trivial. Of course, it's clearly that at least the two things seem different, and they do not seem to depend too much on the dimension. Of course, you may have some tiny dependency on the dimension. The thing that is interesting, that if you do the analytic computation in mean field theory, you find that you can compute the exponent, and the exponent have some apparent irrational number, or at best, of course, it's clear that we cannot claim that the number is rational knowing the first number, but it's certainly not a simple rational number. We looked also to the continuous function expansion of this number, but they do not seem to be very. And this number is definitely different from square root of 2. So we have this type of number, and this number agrees very well, for example, from what we get from numerical simulation. I think that these things here, just this line here, is probably done with an analytic number, and we stay in a somewhat surprising situation, because we are accustomed that when we go, that mean field theory should be valid for critical exponents in dimension greater than something, typically 4 for ferromagnets. And here we do not see any type of dependence of the critical exponent up to dimension 3. Of course, the value of the upper critical dimension depends for the model. It may be for this model is small, but one has to do appropriate computation in order to understand what happens. And also, there are some simulation dimension 2 where people also in dimension 2 does not see too very different result. Maybe there are some logs.
This assumes they are scaling laws, or you prove that they are very fine?
Unfortunately, we verify the scaling law with only 10 to the six, minus 6 precision. But one of the scaling law we proved analytically. The other things we proved with 10 to minus 6 precision, and we were unable to prove analytically. We can do some analytic argument for which it should be due, but if you just look to the questions, it should be... We tried to do integration by part and so on, but we have not been able to prove the second one. I think that one should try to understand better the question. So, therefore, this is situation. Okay, therefore, this what I want to say. Okay, that this picture is quite important from the physical viewpoint. Because if says that in this situation you have many solutions which are not very far one from the other one, you may have the energy barrier for going from one solution as a solution may be quite different from the usual one. You may have a completely different dynamics, both in the quantum case and in the liquid and in the classical case. And of course, this type of exponent, for the this type of exponent that you are going to get, is something that you will never get without having replica symmetry breaking that you need to. Because if you do the same computation for without taking care of replica symmetry breaking, you will get a k equal to 1 or a k equal to 2, depending on some variation of the result, but not certainly k equal to 1.
Do you think that there is some universality?
Okay, I will come to the... Yes, okay, let me try to... Well, for example, if we take the perceptron problem, and we write the same equation for the perceptron problem. The perceptron problem is negative k. We find that the equation is slightly different. There's some slight difference in the equations, since in the boundary condition and so on, but they have exactly the same type of exponent. So at least in these two, we have two different models, which we have a kind of universality. Now, there are other problems for which you can ask if there is things of this type. For example, you can take a neural network model. You can study the problem neural network for neural network, and you can ask, which is quite different. You can now, it is known for the work of Zecchina that if suppose that you have a neural network, the simplest version neural network is one perceptron. The second version of the neural network is that you take two perceptron or three perceptron and you do a small committing machine or an XOR machine. I think that Mark studied the XOR case a long time ago. Now, what is shown by Zecchina that in this case you have a continuous replica symmetry breaking. Therefore, this means that you stay in the game to have some kind of phenomenon of this type in that case, but we do not really, the questions are more complex there, and people have not done a careful analysis of what happens in mean field. Therefore, already at the mean field level, there is a problem understanding universality, because we don't understand if all mean field models of this type or a large class have this type of singularity or other do not have. Therefore, this is certain one problem. And from the phenomenology, therefore, this is one okay, and well, the other things, there are many questions that we would like to understand and for which we would like to get some result. For example, one problem is to do the computation on the long range. As I told you, we know that there are some long range correlations because there are some susceptibility that are divergent. Now, if you want to compute such as a long when you know that the susceptibility are divergent, we know that the correlation decay. But this type of computation has been done by the Dominicis and Condor for spin glasses, and they find a quite complex situation. The type of decay was dependent from the value of replica symmetry parameters that we were looking. Anyhow, you can do the computation was done at least zero loop, and now in principle you would expect also in this case that there are some quantity will have some decay or correlation, and this correlation should decay with some power law that you have to compute. The power law, of course, will depend from the type of operators that you are doing, that you are looking. And the thing that will be very important to have the prediction for the value of the exponent. And now, one thing will be to do the prediction for the value of the exponent in the just in the broken replica phase, because one may hope that everything that happens there is not very different from what is done by the Dominicis and Condor temporal. With some crucial difference, unfortunately, that most of the computation in me may correct me are done at finite temperature, thank you, not at zero temperature. And the extension of the computation zero temperature is something that is non-trivial, as far as I understand already in spin glasses. The second different thing that we want to know, not only on the phase near jamming, but want to know what happens at jamming. At jamming, we know that there are some extra singularity. This extra singularity manifests already themselves in some critical exponent for local quantities, so we may expect that when we arrive to the jamming, also this exponent there will depend from, will be maybe related to the local exponent, will be non-trivial, and therefore we have to set up this computation. The computation is quite complex, but we hope that it could be done. Now, apart from this problem, we have a lot of numerical theoretical questions that you can ask. From the numerical point of view, is what we find that there is a spectrum in which was proportional to omega squared. What happens to this spectrum of omega square when you stay in some dimensions high? The reason that it may be, if you stay in three dimensions, you may confuse, it's just the phonon spectrum. Therefore, you may ask what happens to this object here when you go to higher dimension. The other things that you can do, that a finite dimensional, three-dimensional system can be studied from not very large value of n up to the 10 to the 4. What you, one thing that you can do is to go to higher, smaller value of n, to do in taking high statistics in such a way that you have a much precise value of the exponent. Because one thing is to say the exponent is 1%, one thing is to say that it's 10 to minus 3, the difference in the exponent. You, there's something that you have to understand, if there's something special in two dimensions, because to the first thing says a two dimension looks similar, but if you don't have a high precision, you, for example, you cannot see if there's some log, extra log arising in two dimension and so on. Also, there should be a detailed study of the many quantitative prediction and qualitative also that you can do for near jamming. For example, you may expect ultramitivity of some quantity and so on. And also, you have, the Gardner transition was numerically observed, and one was seeing a correlation length that was increasing up to the 5, 10. However, it's clear that you need a very careful analysis to be sure that this is really a transition and not a crossover. So therefore, also this is something that one should at least change, do finite size scaling in a systematic way. And there is also many problems that comes from a theoretical viewpoint. One problem, what happens when you go to finite dimension? The point that when you do an infinite dimension, if you in first approximation, each point in each particle interacts with a number of particles that order the dimension. Because the typical that happens is when you go to the jamming, the number of contacts is twice the dimension. Now, if you go to and this is quite useful because it allows to use the central limit theorem in some sense to assume that all the functions that were needed in a certain stage are Gaussian functions. This is the same trick that is used in spin glass. However, if you in the Sherrington Kirkpatrick limit, if you use a finite number of neighbors, things become more difficult. And you should try to understand already at the mean field level, which is the effect of having a finite number of neighbors, what happens to the spectrum, what happens to other quantities, if the exponents do not depend. It's quite likely that the exponent will not depend from the fact that we stay in a finite dimension in mean field, because we know that the exponents are very good in a real system, but at least it would be nice to show mathematically that you have. As I told you, we should do the computation, the correlation, the exponent, and also we should try to understand and do a first loop computation. Of course, a first loop computation will tell you essentially where the upper critical dimension, where things, and the one loop computation in this case will be more difficult than the one on spin glasses, which have been not as completely cleaned. Also, so a lot of, I mean, many things have been understood essentially by the work of Cyrano, Kondo, Temcevari. Also, the question is, for example, in the case of the perceptron, which is analytically a simple case, if one can prove that the results that one understands are correct, of course, one can conjecture that they are correct, but one should be able to prove. The problem I have, the problem of universality that we discussed with Dean. Didn't you stand with John? And the problem already is that you have a universality in mean field. Other problem that's quite important, for which I do not really understand, if we have, suppose that we take this, not instead of sphere, ellipsoid, I have no real idea of what happens with the ellipsoid. Because also ellipsoid also is much more difficult to do numerical simulations. And also the thing that one can try to use the question if this analytic understanding can be used to get a better algorithm to find in numeric solution to all the constraints. In other case, like we had other algorithms like the survey propagation algorithm and so on. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Conformal invariance at your jamming transition?
Well, I guess so. I would, sorry. Well, I do not see any simple reason for which it should not be conformal invariant, but of course, I would expect, indeed, I'm trying to understand better how can we better estimate conformal invariance. For example, one thing that would be nice is to do simulation in a two-dimensional strip, and once that you have computed some correlations in two dimensions, to see what happens in the strip, how the decay in the strip is connected to the width of the strip, which is a standard conformal invariant check.
Good. Last question. Plus an AL1 regularizer, and you switch the sign of the regularizer, you end up with exponentially many solutions. It's very similar to what's happening in the perceptron.
Okay, thank you.
It's an
okay, we should explain me better this.
Nicolas, you're the last.
Yes. Could you comment a little bit more on the universality? So, what exactly?
Well, the point, I mean, in this problem we have some definition of, we can define the equivalent of gap, so distance between one particle and another one, the constraints that are satisfied, how much they are from, those that are not jammed, how much they are satisfied, not satisfied. Now this can be computed for all many classes, for all classes of continuous satisfaction problem, and already in mean field theory, and we know how to compute in two cases, and in other case, which for example the perceptron of XOR perceptron, a two-level perceptron, we do not know how to we know how to write the question, but we do not know how to solve the questions. We have to do analysis, and one can ask if the value is universal in this case, at least in the mean field case. The other question where you can, I mean, we have this kind of exponent. The other thing is that we can ask if this exponent is universal in the sense that if you take spherical object or ellipsoids, if the things are going to change or not going from spherical object and ellipsoid.
Thank you, let's thank.
Okay, thank you.